Minutes, gentlemen, minutes of the October and November board meetings. You got those? Looked at them? Questions, revisions? If not, motion for acceptance?
Hold it.
Motion by?
Rich.
Rich, second?
Second.
Second by Dave, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I thought you said something. Public presentations, if there's anyone there that would like to make a comment with regards to the town, you have 3 minutes to get up and say so. Is there anyone here that would like to make a comment? Okay, we'll move on. We'll go with the chair people of the standing committees. We'll start with Parks and Recreation, Councilman Reynolds.
Yeah, in your packet, it's the second to the last page. There are a series of budget adjustments that I'm not going to detail because it's a significant list. Dan, do you want to comment on any of that?
Yeah, I have a few other budget adjustments also, but this one particular with the parks, there's 9 accounts.
Right.
I went over it with Carson, and everything seems, you know, checks out. So it's basically to just move expenditures that have, you know, a deficit and ones that have a surplus so that they're all in line. So everything is fine. It's just increasing certain expenses, decreasing others.
Do we have that before us in the packet here?
Yes, it's second to the last page.
I can go through them if you want. Line by line.
Well, they're available. They're in the packet. I don't see any need to read them unless you want to, Dan. It's pretty straightforward.
Okay.
Let's make a motion to accept these budget adjustments as presented.
Second.
Second by Paul, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous?
The only other thing I'd like to mention is, we've got some, the library board, the police commission, the planning board. There'll be vacancies coming up. I can do that tonight or at a January meeting.
We can do them tonight. I think it's, Paul, it's your member in the police commission.
Yes, Peter could be, yep.
So it would be his nomination and then.
You're on the wait, Gail?
Well, we've been told before that we have to wait until the term actually expires.
Well, that wasn't an election year though.
Yeah.
You qualified at one time.
I would still do it. I'd still wait till the term expires.
All right, just for your information, we've got some openings coming up.
And we did get recommendations from the library.
Yes. That's all I have now.
Public Works, Councilman Messick.
Yeah, I spoke with Chief and Sarah regarding, there's been a couple of serious accidents on Tibbitts and Oxford Road intersection. And he checked with the county, and the county is going to put up a solar beacon eastbound on Tibbitts. My concern, and same with the chief, is putting another one up going westbound to act together. So again, the severity of those accidents have been significant enough to where I think it warrants us to put up one. And the county will install it for us, but we just have to pay for the westbound.
And that's what, about $3,000?
Yeah, just the little.
Did they indicate why they wouldn't pay the other way?
I think it's just based on number of accidents and so forth. But again, I think it's if you recall the last ones, I mean, I think there was two vehicles at the BMW, the Mercedes. It's just to the point where at some point it's going to get the, it could be public safety and, you know, I think it's life threatening. So so I asked the board if we can consider putting that in.
Not a concern, I would, yeah, but just it's a county road.
Well, the county's going to do it. They just want us to reimburse them for that one light. We're not going to do it. The county's going to do it.
Is it going to maintain it afterwards?
It's a good question. I would say no.
Go ahead, Rick. But I think they're going to buy the eastbound light. The eastbound light. They're looking for us to buy the
westbound.
Westbound.
Right.
My only thing is, and they've already contacted me to help install theirs. it's a county, both of those is a county road, and it's a county intersection. Yeah, we get some accidents there, but we get accidents elsewhere too.
No, I know what you're saying.
You know, why get involved with two county roads and a county intersection?
Can we charge them to put the light in?
No, they're charging us to put the light in.
No, I'm saying on the other side, on the eastbound, he said that he was putting it in, help, they called him for help, so.
Well, they went our bucket truck.
Yeah, they, no, they've, we, the chief has already talked to the county doesn't, they're only gonna put one in. And actually, it's, it was almost our choice, right, Jim, from what I understand?
Yeah.
East or west, but they're not gonna put two in. I guess based on their studies or whatever they have, they weren't gonna put two in. But they said that they would allow to and put it in if we were to pay for the other light. Personally, I can't see putting one in, to be honest with you. So, I mean, it's either two or nothing as far as I'm concerned, because having one going one way and then the other one's gonna come flying through doesn't really make much sense.
Maybe we ought to find out if we're gonna have to maintain it all, but we get some.
But what's?
Well, Rick. Maintenance?
Yeah, there's maintenance to it, there's batteries to it. I have two solar powered ones right now on Oneida Street by our salt shed for snowplows. And they're solar powered.
But do you know if the county's gonna make us maintain the one that we pay for?
Probably, I don't know for 100%, but more than likely, yes. We have to fix all their traffic signals on their roads because they won't own a traffic signal. It's.
I mean, I don't wanna split hairs on this. I mean, again, the severity, take that out of consideration. The point is, I wanna emphasize, the level of the, and the severity of the accidents that are happening there. That's what it comes down to. I don't wanna sit there and wait and somebody gets killed because we're worried about who's gonna maintain a battery. Motion on the floor is we put them the light in the kind of town pays for, okay?
Now, what light is this gonna be, excuse me?
It's gonna be westbound coming out from Kellogg.
A triple light, like a red star?
No, it's gonna.
Just a warning light, right? Just a flash.
With a stop sign.
Right, stop sign.
So.
Talk to the county to see who pays for the sign.
Well, I gotta talk to highway. We already found out who's gotta pay for it, yeah.
Who made the decision to put a light one way, I mean?
The county.
No, but who in the county, I mean, like?
The engineer.
Highway commissioner?
Decker, the engineer.
Engineer.
I mean, is there any way we can talk to somebody at the county level to see if they can put an extra light in and maintain it? It is their roads.
Well, I think in addition to that, we should put them on notice that we're aware of multiple accidents on their road, their intersection. In addition to that, it should be mentioned that the whole Kellogg Road corridor, to include Hannaford's Walgreens intersection, is a disaster. There are multiple accidents. I think the county should be put on notice to get that project moved up. It's my understanding that they've got plans to do something with Kellogg Road at some point. Am I correct?
Yes.
Somebody's gonna get run over, people walking on the shoulder of the road. It's a bad situation. And if we're gonna address that intersection, great. But let's go on record putting them on notice that we recognize they've got a serious issue on Kellogg Road.
Okay, well, we've got a motion.
Yeah, my motion.
Was it seconded? Light in. No, I'm going to ask for a second now. We've had the discussion before the second.
Where would the money come out of for us?
No, it's going to Paul.
Are you paying for it?
Thanks, Paul.
The chief, I think, said he's got money left in his contractual. We could make some adjustments and pull it out of there.
Well, we're getting going forward, I guess, is the question.
I'm not worried about the maintenance part. I'm worried about putting the light up. I mean, the maintenance part, we have maintenance
all
over town.
The budgetary portion, I don't think, is a problem.
It's going to be solar anyway, so it's a 10-year life cycle for the light. I mean, and by then, who knows what technology would be out there to change it. So I'm really, I don't think there's really any maintenance to it. But.
I'll second it.
Second by Dave. Discussion. I mean, we're not talking the traffic light here.
Right.
I mean, it's just
a warning light. It's just a highlight the stop sign.
Rick?
if you look in front of Yucca National.
Right.
They have a solar that blinks white lights or a yield sign on their property.
Right.
That's solar powered also, it's like that.
Right.
Only red.
Right.
Right.
I mean, I mean, for that, I'm in agreement with it.
Gotta do it right, both ways.
And we could find the, right, I can't see it doing one way.
Right, you're still gonna have the oncoming traffic, it's gonna accident anyway.
I think that's, it's confusion if there's only one lit stop sign.
Hey, Chief.
Come here, just a second.
Waiting for me?
Yeah. Chief, before you sit down, you gotta, we're talking about the,
Oh, we got a county guy here too.
We have a celebrity with us.
You locked me out.
Our county legislator, Jim Danofrio. We're talking about the intersection up on Tibbitts Road in Oxford, and that light to warn people about the stoplight. Jim made the motion, we got a second, and we're talking about having it on both sides and, you know, what the cost of $3,000. Your comments, your feelings on this thing?
I have been working with Jim on it and Oneida County. Oneida County did a traffic study within the last 2 years. I provided all the crash statistics to them. It is not it doesn't have a high ratio of MVAs, but when it does have an accident, it's a good T-bone accident with substantial property damage and most often personal injury involved. In my personal opinion, it's just a matter of time before we have a fatal crash there. So I think these beacon lights is a good idea myself.
Is it people coming down the hill don't realize the stop?
The majority of the accidents.
Ice.
Yeah, the majority of the accident isn't due to weather, it's due to inattention. Not stopping for their stop sign, they just cruise right through.
Coming down the hill.
But we have had a couple going up, and I think Councilman Ness actually witnessed a near collision not too long ago with a vehicle coming up the hill and failing to stop.
Thanks, Chief. All right, any further discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, unanimous. Mr. Danofrio, do you have anything that you'd like to speak to us about?
I really don't. You have any questions on this whole sales tax debacle? I'm more than willing to entertain any questions or take it from the beginning.
Before we move to that very, very important issue, I'd still like to go back to Kellogg Road.
This is you, Jim, because you're county.
Sure, go ahead, yeah.
We're trying to address Tibbitts and Oxford with a flashing stop sign.
Right.
But I bring up the point that Kellogg Road is a mess, and I'm sure you're aware of that.
I am.
A lot of traffic issues.
Yes.
I know the chief is aware of it. Walgreens, Hannaford intersection.
Yeah.
The diminished lane, the fact that people are walking on the shoulder of the road. I thought the county had some plans at some point to go in there and do the job right from corner to corner. Well, and I understand it's a big project. And my thought is I'd like the town of Hartford to go online or go on record as notifying the county that we recognize that as a hazard and it needs to be corrected.
Right. Let me just say this about Kellogg Road. I just got Kellogg Road in my district a couple years ago. Never was mine. Chapman Road was mine, and I got Chapman Road on the TIPS program, and we redid it. Kellogg Road definitely needs to be redone. Why it wasn't put on the TIPS program, I don't even know, the TIPS program is a combination of federal money, state money, and county money. The county, for all practical purposes, has to just put in like 10%. Feds put in a lot, and the state puts out a lot. This is a historical issue with Kellogg Road,
right.
And quite honestly, I thought Jack Williams years ago actually put it on this TIPS project they have a meeting throughout the state under the transportation plan.
I thought it was on there too.
Right. Well, it got taken off, and I got to tell you the truth. It wasn't mine. Kellogg Road was never mine. I just received Kellogg Road, and since I became that, everybody knows that Kellogg Road needs to be changed with sidewalks and the whole thing. It's a huge project with a whole reconstruction of infrastructure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, there was a point in time when, it goes back several years ago, when it was something like we were waiting for a planning study to be done before they could do the infrastructure or something. But the only way Kellogg Road is going to be done through a major funding program. And it used to be called the TIPS program. I don't know what it's actually called now.
But I will definitely, and quite honestly, I'll definitely revisit that. And the county executive and I have had a conversation about sidewalks there, but you can't just put sidewalks in.
No, I know, it's a big problem.
Without reconstructing the whole place, right?
Oxford and Kellogg ends up as a T-intersection.
Right, right, right. And then, you know what, it's something that I will, as tomorrow goes, we'll revisit it and see if in fact this, you know, it's a two-county transportation program that I used to go to when I was majority leader. I can't remember the name right now, actually. And I'll talk to the people that are on that, and we'll see if where they're going with that. Even if that program, you know, I don't know what, how that program is even funded nowadays, but I'll look into that again. But you can't blame me for that one, because that was never mine.
No, I didn't, I'm not blaming you.
No, I know, no, I know. But it does, it definitely needs, something needs to be done.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
How about the sales tax?
Before we get into anything serious, yeah, go ahead.
Sales, yeah, pardon me?
Take your coat off.
No, this is my shirt, this isn't my coat. Sales tax has been a very, very interesting issue, and what I kept telling, you know, Don Ryan and I talk once a day or every other day, and Pat and I talk, you know, a couple times a day, and that's not, you know, when you talk to Pat a couple times a day, it's not that pleasurable, you know, because most of it's screaming at each other. But, you know, I don't know whether I start from the beginning or the end, but let me start on the end. As sales tax, where it sits now is, there's a sales tax committee that the county executive put together, which is made up of the towns, a few towns, no villages are on it, and the cities. His intention, right from the beginning, was that he wanted to redistribute the sales tax in a more equitable manner. The example that comes up all the time is the town of Forestport gets $1 million, I don't know, like, you know, $1 million, and they have like very few people, you know, as far as population goes. But their assessed valuation is very high because of the camps, right? So there's some inequities out there. And more importantly, I think the county executive's motive, and I don't want to speak for him, but I think he's very open about it, is that the county of Oneida moving forward is going to need more money because we actually this year's budget will be running a deficit, you know. So he wanted to reallocate, I think his motive was to reallocate more money to the county of Oneida, but for him to do that, and he understands that the town of Hartford doesn't receive enough sales tax money, and in this formula, his motives basically is to raise the town of Hartford sales tax dollars, right? But to do that, he has to incorporate the cities in this conversation, and the cities really control whether this conversation goes forward or not, because the city of Utica and the city of Rome preempt, they call it, right? So consequently, they collect, without getting too much detail, they collect half of what's collected in their boundaries. Now, for that sales tax formula to change, for New Hartford to get more, for the rest of the towns to be adjusted, the cities have to agree not to preempt. So consequently, he has to appease the cities in this argument. So what happened when he first announced that his State of the County address, and this whole thing came up in the State of the County address, what happened was I ran some numbers myself because I sat down for a couple hours a couple different times, and I started running the numbers trying to see what we could do for New Hartford and do other places. And I actually went to him and I said, Tony, these numbers don't work. I don't see how you could possibly achieve what you want to achieve by getting the county more money, New Hartford more money, and the cities more money, and still keep, you know, still somehow not devastate the villages and the towns. And he said, well, let's work on it. Well, I honestly think he worked on it very diligently, and I think he saw how hard it was because just the numbers, there's just not enough money to go around to do what he wanted to do, in my opinion. So consequently, he set up a committee. And this committee was made up of three people. Where the committee sits today is he finally, last week, the county executive gave them a draft plan. And this draft plan, which Pat saw, maybe many of you saw it, and Don Ryan definitely saw it, the draft plan was just to start the conversation. And I'm not so sure that he meant that draft plan to get out to everybody, but it did. But quite honestly, he's not the type of guy that keeps things from the press, so he's not afraid of it. As soon as it was presented, it got out to everybody. Because quite honestly, it was just a draft plan to start the conversation within that committee. Well, that draft plan, in my opinion, goes nowhere, right? Because number one, it cuts out all the villages for every dollar they have. The town of New Hartford gets more, but gets very, very little. Town of Kirkland gets a little more, and the town of Whitestown gets a little more. And the rest of the towns get decreased by 27% over a three-year period, or a five-year period, depending how the thing acts. So really, it's again, it was meant, there's no support, in my opinion, for this draft plan. And more importantly, the two things that have to happen. Number one, the cities have to agree, otherwise nothing goes forward for the conversation whatsoever. I don't think he's going to get the cities to agree, number one.
Okay, just let me know, yes. How would he get them to agree? By giving them a little more money?
Absolutely, okay. Absolutely. And in this draft plan, Utica got $1 million, and okay, the Rome got $500,000.
Okay, the other point you said, yes, that amount is diminished after 3 years or 5 years, whatever.
Yeah,
whatever.
27.7%, yes.
Okay, after the max, say 5 years, there's nothing, right? It goes to zero.
No.
It doesn't?
No. It's decreased after 3 years or 5 years. And then, I think, by agreement, it would be revisited. But the problem with this plan is the villages get cut out 100%. So I have a real problem with that. I talk with the people on the committee all the time. As a matter of fact, they call me into their pre-meetings before they go in, only because they need New Hartford to sign on. And I'm not signing on to any plan. And let me just say this at this point. This isn't anywhere close to being settled. I honestly don't think at this point that there's going to be any redistribution, which in a way is not good for the town of New Hartford, but it's good for the villages. When I went into this, and Pat and I had a conversation about this, I went to the committee and I said, I will support this if there's a net gain in the town of New Hartford of $1 million. And what that means is you don't cut the villages, both New Hartford and New York Mills, although I don't represent New York Mills, and there's a net gain of $1 million over a three-year period for the town of New Hartford. Now, whether that's enough or not, listen, it was better than nothing, and I said at that point I could support it. But I kind of knew, I absolutely knew the numbers, and I knew that was not achievable, to be very honest with you. So where you sit now is you sit, then the other thing is the Board of Legislators would have to approve this. This committee first would give a recommendation. Number one, this particular plan will not come out of committee. And it's not a formal committee, it's an informal committee, so they don't really have a vote, but they do a recommendation. This plan I don't think will come out. I don't think they can come up with a plan that would get the support of the whole committee. And even if they did, that means the cities have to approve, the town people on that committee have to approve it, and then it has to go to the Board of Legislators and to the City Council, which they may not approve it either, but it has to go to the Board of Legislators. And remember, how do you pass something through the Board of Legislators when you're cutting all the towns out and villages? I mean, even if you just cut them 27%, you're not going to get, it's just an impossible task at this point. And really, it's unfortunate because, the town of New Hartford, hopefully could have benefited from a redistribution. It's just that, but you can't, in my opinion, I represent the village, you can't benefit the town of New Hartford. Minimal amount of 400,000, Pat? 400,000 and cut the village of New Hartford by 400,000 and the village of New York Mills by about 500,000, So, what I've been telling Don Ryan and everybody else, I've been involved in it right from the beginning. I have my finger on the pulse with it because it's an intellectually stimulating sort of thing to run the numbers. But knowing that, quite honestly, it's really going to be an exercise in futility, in my opinion. But it starts the conversation about shared services and consolidation. You know what? The problem that I have with the county executive's approach towards this is, and I give him credit for starting this conversation, because this conversation has to happen. It's just that you painted the villages with a broad brush, right? The village of New Hartford and the village of Kirkland already consolidated their police forces. We have places in Whitestown, Yorkville, Whitestown, that have three different police forces, and quite honestly, they probably should be consolidated. But but to be honest with you, the village of Yorkville had a referendum years ago, as we all know, and it passed overwhelmingly to keep their police force. But remember, the reason why they were keeping their police force is because the sales tax that they're getting is funding that police force. So it's like, you know, should, and I think the county executive is saying, you know, we ought to, if we cut a certain amount of sales tax out, we will force consolidation or share services. And there really needs to be a move towards consolidation and shared services. But the town of Hartford has done it in many, many ways, so I just don't think you can throw them into the mix.
You mentioned the cities. Do they have enough votes between the two cities on the legislature to move this?
Absolutely not.
And secondly...
Not without New Hartford. Right?
Okay.
Not without me.
Secondly, the every year there's some pressure to reduce the sales tax.
Absolutely.
From different quarters.
Absolutely.
Reduce the sales tax.
Absolutely.
So you're going to divvy up a smaller pot potentially going forward if the sales tax gets reduced.
You know, unfortunately, if you look at the county budget, it really is going to be almost impossible, you know, to decrease the sales tax in the near future. Only because, the county of Oneida, the one thing I'll say about it, it does not waste a lot of money. It really is a very, very, now all government wastes money compared to, you know, small business. I run a mom and pop shop, we don't waste a whole lot of money, you know what I mean? We put a bucket under the roof, I clean the bathrooms, it's totally different. So government, in my opinion, they're not as efficient as the smaller governments are more efficient than the bigger governments. But the county of Oneida, for all general purposes, is not a wasteful government. It's not an extravagant government. Our employees at 911 get paid way too little. Our caseworkers get paid less than anybody in all the counties around. Our county executive and sheriff and officers get paid less than almost everybody. So but the bottom line is, our budget is really hurting going forward. There's no doubt about that. So
if there are some minor consolidations, say the town of Whitestown or village of Barneville, that village doesn't necessarily need to. I don't believe
like
Prospect went out, for example, Barneville, they don't provide any services.
Yeah.
But they get $300,000 or $400,000.
Yeah.
So if you consolidate those, you pick up maybe $1 million.
Any consolidation of a village, you mean?
Yeah.
You know, the interesting thing about consolidating a village is the state has a program that if you consolidate a village within a town or within any entity, but most likely it would be within a town, they come in and they give you 15% of your property taxes. So there's an incentive.
It's a one-time deal.
No, it's every year.
Every year?
It's every year.
As long as it's funded.
And it's deep in the budget where it should be funded every single year, yeah. But you know what? Again, I go back to we can't paint. You know, Don Ryan's gonna come down to the Board of Legislators and he's gonna defend villages, right? We had this conversation yesterday. And I said, Don, where you and I differ is that you have to go down and defend all villages. I don't believe all the villages are as efficient as the village of New Hartford. I don't understand the village of New York Mills. I don't represent it. But the village of New Hartford runs extremely efficiently. They've consolidated their police years ago. There's some other things that you consolidated also, which have been very, very beneficial. The other villages, and you remember, when I keep talking about consolidating police, the police budget in some of these villages is, you know, 3/4 of the budget, if not more, you know. So, I just don't believe there's huge money in consolidation. Listen, this starts the conversation. Maybe we as a county need to get out of the business of roads and give them over to the towns. You know, I would love to see the town of New Hartford not only plow the state roads, 12B, but I'd also like to see the town of New Hartford own some of the roads, like Oxford Road. And we kind of fund it. The problem with that is, do you really want Oxford Road? You know, I mean, do you want to pick up the expense? And we would pay for a certain amount of it by getting rid of our DPW department. You know, I mean, that's an idea but that idea, I don't think, and people are talking about that. They've talked about it for years, but I believe you have to do it on a small basis, and let's try it in different areas.
Each village is different.
Each village is different. Yes.
county road in a village over here is much different than a county road or a village in town in New Hartford.
Yeah. So pursuing a city for the town of New Hartford is something that I would totally support because it's, you know, I think it's going to be the way that's only going to get you more sales tax. Now, it's an uphill pull, as we all know, but it can't hurt to give it a shot.
And if we get more sales tax, somebody else is going to lose.
If you get more sales tax from this particular consolidation, someone definitely loses. If you become a city, you'll bankrupt most of the towns. Because you collect most of it, you know. The county of Oneida knows New Hartford is the economic engine. I mean, I let them, you know, I'm obnoxious down there about that. They know that we collect all the sales tax. They know that our particular infrastructure is stressed by it, the courts, the police. You know, they all understand that. It's just that, you know, I'm one vote. Brian Miller's another vote. That's about all we have, so it's very difficult. But to change the formula in sales tax, you have to go through this particular process where the cities are going to have to lose their preemption. Any other questions? The reason why Pat doesn't like me coming is I always take too much time.
Well, I had a question. Anybody start going down a different road and saying that is like our police, our fire department, they're impacted the most when we have the most commercial district, which have most of the issues.
Absolutely.
And we're funding that. So is there any way the county maybe can come up with a grant or something that can fund and help us with police and fire?
Well,
and then it kind of avoids the sales tax issue,
right,
but brings us money and other revenue another way that other towns and counties can't come up to because they don't have as much commercial district, but make a grant that says, okay, if you have 60% commercial, we'll fund police and fire, a couple hundred thousand, buy vehicles, whatever it might be, but they can fund like a grant situation that could help us. And then we don't need the sales tax offset.
Right.
And then they would have to find that money another way.
But the reason why he wants to offset it through the sales tax is because the county really doesn't have the money. And I'll give you an example. When the Indian money first came in, we were supposed to give the towns a reimbursement because when the Indian money came in the first time, it was like $15 million. Tony Pacenti believed that it was everybody's money. And I think to make it a little more palatable, he kind of distributed some of that money back to the communities. Vernon and Verona got quite a bit. They built a big ag center out there for $500,000. In retrospect, and the city in Rome, the first year, got a grant. The second year, the towns were supposed to get a grant. And quite honestly, that would have been where that money would have come from. The problem was the second year, the towns never got the money because the money still came in from the Indians. Actually, the money has been growing, although it'll probably start decreasing once these other casinos come on. But the money kept growing. It's just the county budget kept getting stretched. Our surplus keeps going down and down. So the bottom line is there really isn't a lot of extra money there by any means. We barely are breaking even, and I think this year we probably won't break even. But the reason why he wants to do it through the sales tax, is because really he was going to fund New Hartford off of the backs of the other income from the other towns. You know, but we're always looking for money to do this. There just isn't a lot of money to go around. And if there was, we would decrease the sales tax, but that's something that it's going to be very, very difficult to do.
So Jim, from what I kind of gathered from your presentation, if you will, it would probably be beneficial, I guess, based on what I'm hearing and the reduction of funds to villages and so forth. In your opinion, would it be worthwhile to entertain consolidating with the village of New Hartford within the town? And I don't know how the infrastructure would tie out, but I mean, in your opinion, do you think that would be a viable step where...
You mean the town of Hartford and the village of New Hartford?
Yes, town.
That's a very good question because Pat and I talk about this, and I have to tell you, you know, I grew up here my whole life. My son lives in the village. The people love the village. I don't know how many of you guys live in the village here. Pat, you live in the village, right? But you live in the village. People love their village, and people love their villages all over. The only difference is that, you know, the sales tax kind of empowers them, especially the police force, and many, many communities don't Many, many counties do not share sales tax, right? The only thing is, what really are we going to save? What really are you going to save by, only because you've already consolidated police, their DPW runs really efficiently, what are we going to save? A couple, you know, a couple office workers in the village upstairs? I don't think that consolidation with the town is really going to save a ton of money, in my opinion. I think the village runs very, very efficiently. But I'm also not a village official or a town official. That's something that you guys would have to really take a long, hard look at. I'm not an expert at it, but from my view from living here, I just think the village runs really, really efficiently. And I just don't think there's a ton of money to save there.
Right, but you also said the town would absorb or get a something, was it from the state?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the name, I mean, yeah, absolutely.
I don't know what that equates to. But.
Well, we ran the numbers on that, too. We ran the numbers on that, and Pat and I ran the numbers on that. That was quite a bit of money. And quite honestly, if you guys became a city, this is where he was going with it. If you guys became a city, the village would have to incorporate, both villages would have to incorporate into the town, and consequently, you would get that extra, we think you would get that extra 15%, and I had the numbers on that, but it was, I don't know, I forgot, I don't know how to throw the numbers out, but it was a substantial amount of money. So yes, if the town consolidated, if the village consolidated with the town as it stands today, the governor's really, really pushing consolidation, there would be a benefit from that particular program to the tune of, I don't know, 300,000, 500,000, I actually have the numbers, I just don't care.
Jim, a question.
By the way, the village of Camden, this is kind of interesting, the village of Camden, if they consolidated with the town, and they got this 15%, Pat, we were talking about this, they would actually lose money, not gain money, because if you think about it, their assessed valuation in the village is more than the town.
Right.
Right?
That's why you can't paint it with the same brush.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, I walked into a meeting with with the, you know, the county executive and some of these other people, and the first thing I asked them, you know, I said, are you guys like village? Why does everybody hate villages? I said here. You know, I come from a place that the village runs really well. But you know, Prospect got in trouble, Dave, with the fire department, with, you know, because they couldn't fund the compensation. Bridgewater years ago. So, you know, there are some places where maybe there's some consolidation.
This plan for redistribution, and it's always thrown in there that the villages would end up with zero. Okay.
Yes.
But if you take some of these villages, you put them to zero, they're probably seriously going to consider dissolving.
Yes.
Which, and if they dissolve,
yes,
and become part of the town, wouldn't that increase our assessment, and therefore we would end up getting more sales tax anyway?
No, because
why?
No, because don't you?
No, it's not.
No, you're right. Yeah, you're right.
No,
yeah.
Villages are separate.
Town and villages are separate. Yeah.
But you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If you eliminate
yeah.
the sales tax to the villages
yes.
and they dissolve,
yes.
and now that property and that assessment comes into the town,
yes.
we would end up getting more sales tax in the town, so it wouldn't be zero anymore. So
right.
where would they get that money?
Yeah, you know, that's an excellent question. I just have to think about it for a second. So right now, and I don't want to take your time, but right now the villages get a portion of their sales tax according to assessed valuation.
Right.
The town gets a portion of assessed valuation. And the town portion, the village is not included into the town.
That's right.
We separate that out, right? So if, in fact, you're not going to give the village resident, if you're going to take that sales tax, and the village of New Hartford is about $450,000 or something, you take that money away, right, from them. So villages no longer are okay, then the village goes into the town. Well, if they consolidated into a town and now it's a whole town function,
you would get that
$480,000 back again.
Right.
Yeah.
So you haven't seen
that's
it
very
anything.
Smart, by the way, because I don't think we didn't even talk about that. I never thought about that. Yeah.
That's why they didn't put
But
me
you
on
haven't
the
saved
minute.
Anything
yeah.
either.
What?
You haven't saved anything either.
But the county
you're just shifting that.
The county had you shifted over to the town.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And
so you haven't saved anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, the county hasn't saved anything, actually they lost.
Yeah, yeah. You know what, I gotta think about how that would work. That's, that is interesting, because, see, right now, he's assuming is that the villages are not going to consolidate into the town, and they're going to lose that portion of their sales tax. And very often, in most budgets, I think the sales tax has got to be about half, isn't it, Pat? It's about half, or maybe a little bit more than half, actually.
Of their budget?
Of their budget, yeah. Sales tax got to be half, or maybe more, maybe more than half. What?
Two-thirds to a half.
It's two-thirds to a half, probably. Yeah. So they were just thinking that that sales tax money would be gone. But if, in fact, they did consolidate into the town, then the town would just, the town of Hartford would get that $400,000 back in sales tax, so you wouldn't save anything, yeah.
Plus 50%.
But that's a good thing. But the bottom line was, you still would have to perform the services in the village. So you still have to have some sort of property tax, or that sales tax would have to pay you as a town to perform those services. But
right.
But yeah, there'd be no savings to the county in that regard, yeah.
So what happens if the village tax then the village pays? That goes away, dissolves?
That goes away.
If they dissolve, it goes away, and then the town would have to pick
services,
it up.
Then.
Well, then the town would have to pick up the services delete the services that the village receives.
But see, what you're assuming, you know, you gotta remember, you got the village and the town, right? What everybody's assuming is that by this consolidation, that the total cost of the village and the town running is going to go down, right? I maintain that some villages it really will, not by a lot, by the way, not by a lot, but, you know, again, what do you think about the village in Hartford? We're going to lose a couple office workers, maybe, you know, and then maybe a DPW person, so you don't save that much, actually. You know?
So we're going to save is where these villages have police departments to...
Well, I think there needs to be, because the police, now again, this is just my opinion, and I'm not an expert at this. The police department in some of these places is, you know, three-quarters, if not more, of their budget, funded by the sales tax. So if they consolidated police, there was a proposal that the sheriff was going to consolidate with Yorkville. Maybe it wasn't smart for the sheriff to consolidate Yorkville, because it went down, you know. Maybe they should have consolidated with Whitestown. Well, they tried to consolidate the fire districts out there, right? Dave, that went down, right?
Yes.
So, you know, it's just tough to get any consolidation. And I'm here to tell you that there has to be some consolidation out there, but it just has to be done smart and step by step, you know? Like the road issue, the road idea that I came up with. You know, maybe we need to sit down, the county ought to come up with a proposal and say, you know, if you take Oxford Road, how much money are we going to give you? And to give you money, that means, you know, we got to get rid of a person or two. You know what I'm saying? We can't just give you the money without us saving money. It's got to be a true consolidation. You know, you guys are going up and down Oxford Road, you know, maintaining it. Why should the county have to come and maintain it? Although you do the plowing, but I'm talking about other things.
Well, it's a lot more than the plowing. You've got infrastructure, you've got drainage. You got catch basins, ditches.
Absolutely.
I mean, there's a lot. It's not just the paved surface.
Dave, I'm not even talking about plowing, because we already paid you
to
plow.
Right, right,
right. I mean, we pay for the cleaning of the grass.
Correct.
You know.
Correct.
So I mean, I'm talking about paving. I'm talking about striping and paving and stuff like that. So I don't know.
How much you generated for the village tax revenue? It's got to be way more.
Sales tax?
No, an actual tax, village tax.
Generally. Oh, the property tax, huh? How much, Pat?
About $390,000.
So he used to be on the village board, Pat did. But we've been looking at it, too.
That's when it was first incorporated as a village.
Well, once you get that up, you got to make that up also.
That's
once
right.
You get rid of that. So you got to make the $300. If you get the $480, you're really only getting $1.80, right? You still got to provide all the services.
Well, not only that, but the residents are going to have to pay for their garbage. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's no benefit there.
You've got a probably a police or a fire commission that is a taxing authority, so there's another tax that's got to be paid.
Well, it would be the same thing that the town residents pay now, as far as fire districts go.
Well, again, that's up to the fire commission. They're the taxing authority, not the town board.
But the board approved the budget.
No. Fire commissioners approve the budget.
Well, they submit the budget to the town, and the town puts it out for public hearing, and it goes into the town budget.
It has to go for a referendum, yes.
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry it took so much time.
We're always happy to have you.
No, you're not. You tell me don't come because you think those things.
No, you.
Because Angie told me, okay, you're done. Sit down. I said, no, I'm done when I'm done. You know, because he used to like to just hear what he wanted to hear. You know?
No, it's always a pleasure to have you here. And I just want to say, Jim does it. How?
Yeah, I'm gonna go home. I haven't been home yet. I'm gonna go home and have my pasta bazool.
Well, you stop there just to get some to eat.
Hey, Jim.
Thanks, Jim.
Before you move on to your matters,
yes.
One more thing, it's on the agenda. Your office might get a call with that. So, Joe Hansel, 9415 Elm Street, called and just not really complaining, but asked about the sidewalks from the Sequoia Creek Bridge up to Oneida Street. I don't know if it's both sides or not, it's not a big stretch, but. Be concerned, you know, in terms of safety and just extending the sidewalk. So I just like bring up to your attention the board just case it goes any further.
It's been brought up before. As a matter of fact, we did do some sidewalks out there several years ago.
We had a committee looking at sidewalks
up to the United Street from the.
The whole area, I don't know if they had a plan at that point, but they were looking at it. You want to wait for Rick to come back in about the county and the Grand Hill stuff and
yeah.
Okay. When Rick comes back in, we'll get back to this. But if he's talking with Jimmy, it may be tomorrow. Okay, why don't we move on? We've got we got a couple of contracts here for the animal control. We've got the first one here, which is with. The town of Kirkland to provide we have it? I've got the vet thing here.
That you got the water bill clinic?
Yeah.
Yep. That should be one.
And we got the town of Kirkland also, are we doing? Or no?
Yeah, yes? You've got that, don't you? Mm-hmm. I think Gail has that, yes.
Okay.
It's in here.
All right. And that's the same as last year, Mike?
No, it went up 1,000, went up to 16,000.
Yeah. All right. We have a motion to approve the contract with the town of Kirkland to provide animal control services.
So moved.
Second. Motion by Paul, second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The other one, we've got an agreement here again. It concerns the animal control. It's with the Waterville Veterinary Clinic. They provide some euthanasia services for us, right?
Emergency care, yes.
And emergency care. And the rates and everything are the same as what they were last year, Mike?
Yes.
Okay. We have a motion to.
Make a motion.
Allow me to sign this and approve it. Motion by Paul, second.
Second.
Second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. And the third one we've got here is with Stephen Swan for the services that they provide on some of the larger animals, et cetera, et cetera. I had the chief take a look at this. He said the fees are the same as they were last year. So if I could have a motion to allow me to sign that for the 2017 year.
Make the motion.
Motion by Paul, second.
Second.
Second by Dave, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Okay. We've got a part-time position open for a police officer with the PD. I know it's in here someplace. Okay. The chief has recommended Philip Brockway. Mr. Brockway is with the Sheriff's Department now, the Oneida County Sheriff's Department now. He's been there for 25 years?
No, about 37.
37 years. I was close. he's done a lot up at the Sheriff's Department. I mean, a lot of different departments and stuff. So he's a well-versed individual. I guess one of the big things is, besides all of his experience and stuff, he wants to work weekends, which is a tough position for us to fill now. A lot of guys don't like to work weekends, et cetera, et cetera, so it's tough to get this. He's got a lot of experience. He lives here in the town of Hartford and Washington Mills. He knows the town, et cetera, et cetera. So I would like to have a motion to appoint Phil Brockway as a part-time police officer starting January 2nd, 2016.
I make the motion.
Motion by Paul, second?
Second.
Second by Dave. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous? Okay. I think... Pardon me? Surplus vehicles? What do we got going, Chief?
We got two cars going here.
A 2014 Ford Taurus and a 2011 Ford Crown Vic. I got the VIN numbers here. Both we'd like to declare surplus and have the highway superintendent get them auctioned off.
It's on Auction International, right?
Yeah, that's the issue there. Right. Motion to classify these as surplus, these two vehicles. Motion by Paul, second.
Second.
Second by Dave, all in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous? All right, what else we got here?
So we need to authorization for you to sign the Oneida County application for grants for the youth employment director.
Yeah, that's coming under Rich, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just under your department?
Yes, because Rich, go ahead. Whatever you got.
Here we have the authorization for the town supervisor to sign the Oneida County Youth Bureau Agreement. I make the motion that we do that.
Second?
Second.
Second by Dave. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous? Anything else? Okay. Gentlemen, before we get into my stuff, we'll get into Danny's stuff, but anything else?
Did I give you the resolution on the keys and the electrical?
Yeah, we were supposed to set it up for a meeting for a public hearing.
Do you have the resolution?
No, not with me.
Okay. It's got to be done through local law, right?
Yeah.
So we have to have a public hearing?
Yes.
We're going to set the date this week, this month.
But do we have the law? We've got to have the law first, or the amendment, right, before we do that?
The resolution.
Yeah.
Right. Why don't I finalize the resolution? I'll get it to you for the next meeting, and then we'll start.
Well, the only problem is the fees start for January, so we don't bring it.
Plus, it's going to be 30 days after we do it anyway, right?
Right.
So we can do it next month and just. Hold off on collecting the fees until it's
okay.
Processed.
When's the next meeting? Isn't it?
Yeah, I said if you want to have, unless you want to have a special meeting.
January. I don't think we need a special meeting for that, do we?
No.
All right, so January 11th, you'll have the resolution, yep. And then we can go from there. But then can we pass something that we hold off on collecting the fees then?
Well, it's already in our ordinance now.
We're not going to get many coming in January, do we?
If we have to reimburse somebody, it's...
We don't get a lot of fees coming in January for...
Well, that's the sign-up period, but the electrical inspection...
So we have to have the fees in place at that point? Yeah. Or can we change it afterward?
We'd have to refund people, right?
Code reads, it starts in January.
I'll work with Joe. I'm going to be with Joe tomorrow, so I'll work with him now.
All right.
So could we extend the period though? So if once we get the fee structured out, we can post in the paper saying that we're going to change it. So
well, it's in the local law.
Right, we're going to amend it.
Right.
That's what we're amending is the local law.
Right, but what I'm saying is that
I know what you're saying.
Extending the period.
Right.
So if we have a certain period of what it is now, what it's going to be later, more people might come and join. But if we close the period off of time that they can do that.
Right, if we amend the local law, we can expand it here.
Okay, all right. So you'll add that in the resolution? Okay.
Okay, are we clear on that?
You got a few things from Rick here. There's a contract.
Okay, getting back to the highway. Rick, you got an agreement from the county soil and water?
Yes.
With regards to some revised plans, and they are going to do the permitting, et cetera, for Grange Hill project. And to do this, they just want a measly sum of, I think it's $45,460 or $405. So, we need approval by the board for me to sign that so that we could have, the reason that they're doing the permitting and stuff is because it'll get through DEC a lot quicker than if you have a private engineering firm do it. I would need board approval to sign that contract so that.
Where would that money come from?
We've got to we'll set up a capital account for it. And probably by the time we get into the big stuff, we're going to have to bond for a lot of it. Right now, there's also a grant that I would like approval to sign, which is the state grant for $100,000
yes.
for the Grange Hill.
Yes.
So at least part of it, some of it will be, that $45,000 will be covered out of there. And then we have some remainder. And we still have, and we should have Jimmy here, but I think Jimmy is going to extend that money from soil and water that was sitting there before.
That's why I asked him when I got him out in the hall.
Okay, and he said yes, right? Because I talked to him about it before, and he said he would get it extended.
Yep.
So we have money from there that will probably cover the $45,000. Plus, we got the $100,000 from coming from the state. So basically, I would ask for a motion to allow me to sign both. The state grant for $100,000 and the agreement with the county soil and water to so they could do the permitting, et cetera, to the tune of, I think it's $45,600.
So will that come out of the bond when you get the bond? Or
it'll probably come out of the grant or one of them. I mean, we've got three sources of funding right now that I'm looking at. One is the county is going to come up with around $80,000. from what they promised before, they're going to extend that. We've got this $100,000 that we're looking at from the state, so that's about $180,000. And then whatever the remainder of the project is, once we get the specs and the bids in, we'll go out the bond for. So to say it's coming out of wherever, it's going to come out of one of those.
Right.
Okay, because they'll all be grouped in as revenue going into that capital fund. It'll come out, it'll be paid for. It's not going to be paid for out of some other budget. It would be paid for either through the bonding or through the grants.
When we bond, we're still going to look at the other projects too that we got in town, Tilgan.
Yes. Yeah, we'll do one bond, and it's cheaper to go out to do one big bond than it is to do all the others.
This is a project we voted to do the whole thing with.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So I'll make the motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And this motion allows me to sign both, gentlemen.
Yes.
Yep.
Is that okay, Counselor?
Yep.
Can you verify who moved in second?
I move. Dave second.
Jim?
Unanimous. Okay, moving on. Was there something else, Gal, that you mentioned?
No.
Okay. Bills. Questions on the bills?
There was one that Dan was going to look at.
Yeah, I believe what that was, now that I'm thinking about it. Today when Lisa was printing those out, she had a problem printing, so she had to void that one that sat and just reprint them, so it was a void and a reissue. So I'm almost positive that's what that was, but I'll double check on that.
December's the registration.
Is there one you want to hold off?
Or he's got it.
Oh, you got it.
Yeah.
But they don't probably.
All right. For the rest of them, any questions? If not, a motion to accept?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Paul, second by Dave. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Okay. The monthly reports. Dan, do you want to come up with this stuff? You got monthly reports, Dan, and you got some budget adjustments,
right?
Well,
the usual monthly reports that you get ahead of time, I send them out emails. Questions on anything? Nothing looks alarming or out of line from my review. Everything seems to be in line. But if there's any particular questions, if not, I have a couple other budget adjustments. Again, these were in the packet, you should have seen them towards the end. Gail has a copy. The first one's in the highway department, and there's like five line items that are just, again, adjusting for over budget situations. I can go over, there's five different ones, I can go over these individually if you want, but they were in your packet. The only other budget adjustment in highway was for $4,500 to take money out of items for SAC line item and put it into equipment in order to purchase a set of biking lanes on trucks 83 and 86 that are over 15 years old. So that's the highway department budget adjustments. I don't know, do we have to do these separate? I have one for police also. Are they separate?
No, I don't think so. Unless the board has a discussion on them.
Right, and then on police, we have a budget adjustment to account for a grant coming in of $25,000 from the Department of Criminal Justice. So we're increasing that revenue line item, and we're going to put it towards equipment. That's what the grant is for, to purchase 9 radar units and some cameras and camcorders. And we're also going to take $12,000 out of personal services to put up in that equipment line to cover the cost of those. That's the adjustment in place.
Is that it? Is that all?
Yeah.
Gentlemen, do you have any questions on these? If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept them.
Motion.
Second. Motion by Paul, second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
To revisit an issue from the last board meeting, Dave brought up a question on these, relates to the chargebacks from the county.
The last page of it.
Yeah, it's in the packet. Dave asked that I call down to the county and kind of get an understanding, so I did that. There's like 21 line items on this chargeback, so you know what these are. These are tax bills that originally went out by us.
Yeah.
That didn't get paid, so the county made us whole. Now they're charging us back because what these specific things are small pieces of parcels of property, mainly undeveloped pieces of property that are up by the old Carats up on Route 5.
All those paper lots up there?
Yeah, that butt up to other property, but nobody really owns them. They're in the name of the Oneida County Board of Legislature, so they're getting charged that special $20 unit charge for sewers, and they really shouldn't be. So I had Darlene check into that, and she verified, the same thing. So they either need to be taken off the tax roll, or the code for that special charge needs to be changed, so it's not there anymore, basically. It amounts to $420.
So the county made us whole. But there were charges that they shouldn't have been charged.
Right.
Okay.
But in order for Darlene to make that change on the, on the tax roll, she obviously needs a board resolution to do that.
And the reason it came up is because it's in the budget as an expense.
It's always been in the budget.
Not as a separate line item, right?
And so that's one item. And doing this, there was something else I discussed with the county. There's also a group of items on here. I think there's 23 of them that are called unknown owners. And these are all throughout the town. Again, small pieces of property that adjoin other properties that are not owned by anybody. They're basically, I guess, owned by the town. So again, these tax bills go out, they don't get paid. The county makes us whole, they're charging us back for that.
Who are we billing? You said the tax bills go out.
The name is unknown owner. We have the addresses. Darlene went through and actually printed all these out and came up with all of the exact addresses.
Again, Herb's asking, they go out with the name unknown owner?
Darlene, I assume they do.
It's on the roll.
Well, who do we mail it to?
The unknown owners, what's on it?
Yeah, but you mail it to us at the property.
And do they come, all come back?
They all come back. And what it is that, it's like the back of the neighbors, like the two houses, it might be a little strip of land. And that's what's unknown, the unknown owners.
We can go up and ask the county, we don't necessarily have to auction. Why don't you take care of this? You're in real estate. I go with the guy with experience.
Yeah, I mean, Darlene actually printed out.
Would you look into this seriously, Paul? And I don't know if, we don't have to auction these. I mean, we could go.
Well, no, the county would auction them if their back taxes had been unpaid.
They've never done anything.
It's not the county, it's ours.
I know.
Yeah, but they're making us whole.
Yeah, but they're not unpaid because they're our property.
They're the town's perspective.
They're charging it back on us. But what I'm saying is, they usually, after several years, there's a county tax and a town tax.
Yeah, but what the county's saying is, we own those pieces of property, the town does.
But on Route 5, somebody would say town.
All those pieces, all those parcels we own, I mean.
That's what the county's saying, because they were never deeded off when they did all that subdivision.
If you look on Route 5 and pull a tax map, someone will, it'll be town of New Hartford owns them. There'll be little strips of land that go all through there.
Right, because we have that situation going on now in New York Mills. There's a piece that's surrounded because they're having some issue over there, which they're gonna try to get annexed into the village of thing, but it's basically town of Hartford. We never knew.
The neighbors might wanna buy them if we auction them.
Right, well, I don't even know if we have to auction. Do we?
You have to abandon them, and then I would think you'd auction them.
Would you?
Yeah, I'm looking into it.
Get that list from them, and maybe you could talk to these owners, either by phone, or go visit them, or if you need some help, let me know.
Sure.
Work with you, and just see if anybody's.
Well, if we don't auction them, I know this for a fact, you've got, because I've done some of this in Herkimer, I bought some places. You gotta have an appraisal done on each one, which is costly.
Yeah.
But if you do an auction, you don't have to have the appraisal done.
No, you just auction them.
Not to belabor this, but to belabor this.
Pat, Dan has the list of all the people surrounding the properties involved here, and he has labels. So if we do something, we're ready to put the labels on their envelopes, and we have the names on the list.
All right, Paul, would you?
Yeah, can I get the list from Dan?
Just see where it is and where we're going with this thing.
Okay, Dan, under district, it says New Hartford Consolidated Sewer 1, right?
Yes.
The segment above that, is that New Hartford School District? Owner New Hartford, NH?
I don't know, I don't know.
And if it is that school district that should be paying that back and not town of Hartford?
I asked that question. I didn't really get a straight answer. Darlene, do you have any insight on that?
Well, I'm taking it that it's New Hartford, it's the name of it, is what they named that sewer district.
It's a sewer district, it doesn't exist.
Okay, so Sewer District 1 is different than NHSD?
Yeah, I think those that are labeled NHSD are, if you look at the tax map numbers, they're repeat from some of the ones that are above that. So I think those might be the sewer district charge. I don't think it's a separate, I don't think it's the school district. We can, you know.
That should be clarified.
I think I understand what you're saying, Dan. The ones, like I said, I told Dan that they had repeated some of the numbers, like the 328-006-1-24.
Not only did they repeat the numbers, they repeated the cost.
Yeah, that's what I told.
It all goes into the total.
Correct.
So there's an issue.
It's a duplicate, correct.
All right, can you look at this again and see what's legitimate, what's not legitimate?
So as far as the $20 sewer charges, are we gonna get a board resolution for Darlene to go ahead and the ones that are the sewer charges, the unit charges?
Well, that looks to be straightforward. If Darlene is $20 across the board for sewer district.
Well, again, because this is, these are the same properties, like.
Not the sewer district is different. The ones that are labeled cancel special districts charge, NH Consolidated Sewer One, all those $20 items.
Yeah, what is that again?
Those are all the ones that are up by Karat's.
Right, Concord Ave or whatever.
Yeah.
Streets that were never developed.
Yeah. Don't have it, they're undeveloped, no sewers on them, that really need to have the code changed, so they have to charge them.
We know for a fact that there's no sewers up there?
I don't.
Do we have sewers up there? No?
And you know, there's been some development up there too. There's a few new houses on the end of.
They had extended.
Yeah.
Sewers to them.
Right.
The other lots do not.
These lots are in the woods behind.
They're within the district.
I know, I did all the research. These lots are actually behind in the woods.
There's no access, there's no road.
There's no road. It's just they're back in the woods and they got their lots over there. Yeah, well, no, I mean, if we put a road in there, not anymore, but right now they are. Like one lot's landlocked to another one.
There are probably subdivisions that never got.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was supposed to be a development up there, I guess, at some point, right? And then it never came about.
Okay, Boyd, what are you gonna do?
Well, shouldn't we? Can't be charging sewer tax up there, no sewer, right? It's just imaginary.
Well, if there's no sewer line up on the main road, no, if there's a sewer line on the main road, then we could charge it.
Right.
That's why I asked Rick.
There's no road.
There's no, well, there's, it abuts to a road, those properties abut to a road or no?
One does, and then the rest in the back don't. Those were supposed to be lots that were, a road was supposed to put in at one time. Like if you look at a tax map, it actually shows a wraparound and everything, but there's no, the road dead ends. Yeah, the road dead ends, so there's nothing there. Am I right, Rick? I mean.
The paper roads.
Yeah, so it's.
All right, what do you guys wanna do?
It's a little bundle.
Well, we pay it to the county, that's not, but I guess the question now is, are we gonna pass the resolution so that Darlene can take these off so we don't just continue?
Just the district charges right now, because you wanna investigate all the others.
No, we're just doing the ones on the bottom.
Basically the $20 jobs.
Right. The ones that Dan's got bracketed.
The $420.
Right, $420.
Okay, now that we got it all picked out what it is, can I have a resolution to get rid of them?
I'll move it.
Second? Second by Paul, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous.
Okay, all of them? Okay, please.
Hey, Danny, what else you got?
Did you do a resolution on the vouchers or no?
Yeah.
It's all set?
Yep.
No, that's it for me.
Did you say no?
Yep.
No, I said they did.
We did do a resolution.
Yeah.
You've got it. Okay. Nothing else, gentlemen? I'll ask for a motion.
I still got the.
Wait a minute, Rick. Go ahead.
I still got the contract with Rick. For Brian.
Is that why you're raising your hand?
For what?
Is that why you're raising your hand about the Brian contracts?
No.
Oh, okay.
Just that, now that we got two more police cars, I want the auction, the auction's international. What can I do? I've got paperwork here to show you what I do. We've had no issues. I got a police car right now on there, it comes off tomorrow, they went with the old contract way. And by the time it's gone, we're getting $2,000 for it, it doesn't cost us a penny to get rid of these. If I go the other route, then I go with the county for eBay, and I have to pay them a percentage to get rid of them.
Did we ask them to provide us proof that they're bonded?
They will, I can ask that, yes, they are.
I think that's all you need, is proof that they're bonded. If they default on the payments, we can make the claim.
But I have the paperwork, when something goes on auction, they send me accept or decline. I accept if it's good, other stuff I've declined, because I wasn't there.
Right, the lag time in receiving payment is what, a week?
And then they send me an invoice saying it's been paid, what day, and then they send a check.
Right, we don't release the title until they've been paid.
No.
No, we have to, it's their rules that we have to release the title.
To who?
To whoever buys it. That's the way they work. Every one of the auctions companies works that way.
So the person who's buying it gets the title before they've paid?
They paid Auction Internationals.
No, what I'm saying to you is, has Auctions International been paid at the point the title is released to the buyer?
Yes, and I get proof of that.
And Auctions International is bonded?
Yes.
To cover any loss?
To cover any loss,
pay us.
Yes.
And I think you have to use it.
Well, no, I mean, we don't have any other choice. He's been trying to find somebody else.
Well, you can use the county, but this is a better deal.
Yes.
The board in favor of this arrangement, I mean, it's actually the arrangement we've been using, but we just wanted clarification. Okay, go ahead, Rick.
Thank you, thank you.
One more thing before we go. We go into executive session, because I'm going to forget this, Paul, okay? Let me get this out. Back in October, we shut down the public skating for about a month and a half, I think, right, Carson? At the time, I know, and I keep forgetting to bring this up to the board. At the time, Marco Terry, who runs the pro shop over there, came to see me and he says, you know, we don't have this anymore. That's a big part of my revenue, renting skates, et cetera, et cetera. I told him, I said, let me talk to the board. We'll make an adjustment. My feeling is we make an adjustment to his run. After talking with him and then talking with John today, we felt that, you know, if we were to knock off a month and a half rent for him, that would make him at least better. I mean, he's done a good job over there. And without that public skating, his revenue was probably...
His contract was based on so many hours.
He bid on it.
We cut the hours.
He bid on it based on past...
I'll make a motion to make that adjustment.
Public skating.
Month and a half, is that what we...
6 weeks.
Six weeks.
Second.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So if you want to send that out and let him know that we did make that...
Okay.
I made the motion, Paul.
Yeah, I second.
Okay.
All right, got a few...
Is this going to take one?
No, real quick. We got a few contracts here for Brian Agreement.
Did you start this a few minutes ago?
I started this three times, I'm not going to start it one, but this one I'm going to make it happen. So, we have three contracts here for Brian. Prices are the same, 18 cents and 23 cents for...
Who are they to?
For a signature for, one is White's, let's see, one is White's Town. It's got to be signed here. Everyone here is Bridgewater.
These are ones we previously dealt with, correct?
Right, and it's and the price is the same, 18 and 23, yep.
Is this all just one contract? Or is there two of them?
There's three, three copies. You might want to sign them on Friday.
What do you want to do?
You might want to sign them on Friday, because there's a lot. There's three copies of each contract. There's brine, there's salt, and there's fuel.
Okay.
So the motion is
to approve all three towns, New York Mills, Bridgewater, and...
Okay, motion by Paul, second.
Second.
Second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye. All right, got another one. This is for ice control. I have an agreement here for three copies again. Village of Yorkville, New Hartford School, and New York Mills School. So I make a motion that we approve those.
Second?
Second.
Second by Jim, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous?
And then this one here is for the fuel agreements. Again, there's for New York Mills, Willowvale, New Hartford. And I make a motion that we approve the fuel agreements. Prices, they went up on this, right, Rick?
They go every week, whatever we pay, we charge them in nickels, it's been like that forever.
Right.
That's a three-year contract. Our last one is up, that was 3 years, the same thing.
Okay, same.
So it fluctuates based upon what we pay.
Yes.
Motion by Paul, second?
Second.
Second by Dave, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous. Get it?
Yes.
Gentlemen, got anything else before we go into executive session? If not, I'll ask for a motion to go into executive session to discuss union negotiations between the highway and the PVA.
Make a motion.
Second.
Motion by Paul, second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Danny, would you stay? Please. Okay, we'll see.
Looking for a motion to approve the Teamster Local Union 294 agreement with the Town of New Hartford and the Highway Department and Assessor's Office for the period running from January 1, 2011 through 12/31/2020, as outlined in the proposed agreement that's been presented. And this approval will be contingent upon final review
by our town attorney, Herb Cully.
Make the motion.
A second?
Okay, motion by Paul, second by Rich. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous. Okay, then the next one we have is negotiations with the Town of New Hartford PBA. This contract would be running from 2017 through 2020. Since we are running towards the end of the year, the contract's at the end of the year, terms have been given to you. I would ask that approval for the contract be made contingent upon, again, review and by our town attorney.
Make the motion.
Second. Pursuant to the written handout dated December 14, 2016.
Motion.
Motion by Paul, second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. By the way, gentlemen, I forgot to say, this contract has already been signed by the union and voted on by the members. Okay, any other business before we move to adjournment?
Pat, Gail asked me to remind you that you didn't set the meeting for the next meeting.
Thank you. Yes, our meeting for January 1st will be January 11th, 2017, 6 o'clock. That will be not only our regular meeting, but our organizational meeting. Okay. That being said, anything else before we adjourn? Motion for adjournment?
Motion.
Motion by Paul?
Second.
Second by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much, gentlemen.